If we ask the question, what is aging, the answers come back as very absurd or overly reductionist. Everyone has a pet theory, and invariably it is usually something involved with their business plan or academic career. In the words of Upton Sinclair, it is most difficult to get a man to understand something if his salary depends on him not understanding it. So when we look at old or premature aging individuals called progerics, one of the most interesting studies I heard was from Steve Horvath, the discoverer of the epigenetic clock. What he found was a 95% correlation with which genes were silenced and how old the cells were. But he found that when you look at prematurely aging young people who are phenotypically old and about to die of old age, their epigenetic age is young. So the takeaway from that was not that he was wrong, but that his theory was incomplete. In other words, the cells hadn't lived long enough and reproduced long enough in their lineage to acquire all the epigenetic silencing, but the cells nonetheless were epigenetically young and phenotypically old. So when we look at it from 10,000 feet, aging appears to be a gradual depletion and a degradation of our cells. And particularly important are the cells of the immune system and the mesenchymal stem cells, which play many different roles in both differentiating into multiple cell types and also coordinating repair, maintenance, and regeneration. So the way that the depletion and degradation of these stem cells occurs, the immune cells and the mesenchymal stem cells, is probably via genetic mutation and through epigenetic variation or silencing through time. And we'll discuss that further in this lecture. A final point that we need to consider is that although as humans we like to think of our genes and our lifestyles playing major factors, in fact they do not. If you look at cars, I'll take any car off the lot that is new versus a car that has 600,000 miles. So it doesn't matter if you live in a blue zone of Costa Rica or Okinawa. Lifestyle only mitigates slightly. And also, when you look at genes associated with longevity, unless you have a hit, as we'll discuss later, most people are destined to live into their 70s and 80s and no farther. So what is most important in terms of aging is actually the mileage or the amount of years that you've lived. Since 2007, I've been interested in telomeres and telomerase activation. This is because when you look at the literature, it appears that nearly all diseases can be associated not just by correlation, but perhaps by causation with telomere shortening and dysfunction. The telomeres shorten, and this allows for cells to mutate in an infinite number of ways and become damaged, senescent, and depleted. Now, stem cells that have increased telomerase activity, interestingly, become epigenetically older. This, as shown in a study by Liu et al. In 2018, shows that when you keep a cell longer, it becomes more silenced in terms of its epigenetic age. Contrast that with the slide previously, which is that very old, prematurely old people who have damaged cells can be epigenetically young, and we have a more complete understanding, which is that although a cell can be slowly epigenetically older, indeed the function of it depends on how pristine its genes are and the expression of those genes. So is this a contradiction? No, I don't think so. If you keep a car part for 600,000 miles, it will have many other problems. Whereas if you break a car part that's fresh out of the factory, it will have problems but not appear to have all the other sort of accumulated rust, if you will. So gene silencing, as evidenced by the epigenetic clock, is basically a function of how old that cell's lineage has been around to gather dust or rust or incidental gene silencing. Stem cell dysfunction is inevitable, but depletion can be mitigated by several different ways. We can clean them, we can de-differentiate cells to make them younger, and we can also engineer replacement or replenishment through cell ecology. In other words, we can turn up the replication of younger, healthier cells. All this relates to exosomes. Stepping back, we look at my five-dimensional model of aging. The system, of course, if it runs for 600,000 miles or 100 years, is flawed. But there are certain areas where we can modify and hack it, if you will. The first three principal understandings are represented by the Trimurti of the Hindu theology, which are Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. That is creation, maintenance, and destruction. The fourth dimension is time. Of course, mileage, how many days, months, years, how many thousands of miles you're running the engine and the car. And finally, the fifth dimension is one of entropy, or a tendency towards disorder. Disorder not only in the genetic code that make up the genes and their expression, but also in the software, which is the epigenetic silencing, or the very conscious turning on and off of genes that occurs, both as an incidental and as an intentional way of producing cell phenotype. So we have to say that everyone has their pet theories, and we'll accept any facts and reasonable theories, but they have to be included into a functional model of aging with an emphasis on things that are universally true rather than whatever pet theories we happen to harbor. Starting with the first of our Trimurti, or the Brahma, the creator, this is symbolized by stem cells, which are mesenchymal, also hematopoietic. So in the young people, we have plentiful amounts of healthy, non-silenced mesenchymal stem cells and blood-producing stem cells. In an older person, we have fewer. The young cells behave more robustly. They dance around, they copy, and they are very responsive, whereas the old ones, less so. This picture of this Dutch lady on the right, who said that she only had two clonal variants of stem cells. What does that mean? There are minor changes in your signature or fingerprint of all these cells. In this lady, she only had two versions of her stem cells when she was ready to pass as a much older lady, over 110 years old. This is concerning. Of course, if we want to mitigate this, we could do adult stem cell banking, which we in fact have seen some people do. It's kind of like having a rechargeable battery. You take out stem cells from your bone marrow and you store them cryogenically. When you thaw them years later, you can actually multiply them to billions and billions of numbers and replenish the battery, if you will. In this methodology, the isogenic, meaning from yourself as opposed to somebody who's not a matched donor and therefore will produce graft versus host or host versus graft immunodisease, is preferred, and asynchronous is preferred. In other words, if you could take a transfusion from your current self versus your young 24-year-old self, you would prefer, in most cases, to take the younger version of yourself. Finally, exosomes could also induce dedifferentiation and induce proliferation of stem cells of all types. And that's exactly what they do when we're injured and we're trying to repair. The second aspect of aging is Vishnu, the preserver, and this is symbolized by stem cell maintenance. So a stem cell is a cell that makes a perfect copy of itself and a more differentiated daughter. And secondly, stemness is described as immortality. Immortality is primarily a function of telomerase activity. In other words, the telomerase active in stem cells allows the ends of the chromosomes to stay long, not erode down to their nubs, and allow for cell mutation and death. So dyskeratosis congenita is a form of progeria or premature aging. And it can be produced by a single copy instead of two copies of any of the components on the right. Those three components are the telomerase enzyme, the RNA component, or TERC, and then this other component called discarin, which is alternatively spliced so that it is able to operate this little triad and lengthen the telomeres. In stem cells, yes, but in regular cells, no. So telomerase activation via many pathways is a blessing, mostly, and it is found that across species, and even within our own human species, people with more telomerase activity tend to live longer and be healthier. Now, as I alluded to earlier, if you keep a cell alive for a long time, then this incidental gene silencing or epigenetic clock will still occur. So it's like maintaining your carburetor for 600,000 miles. It's going to become rusty and start to disintegrate on a molecular level. So be careful what you wish for. Of course, if you preserve stem cells, then you're allowing for fewer mutations and therefore hopefully slower depletion of the stem cell pool, although incidental silencing is still occurring of many, many genes, and that's also an aspect of aging. Finally, exosomes could induce better expression of autophagy, or cleaning out of the cells, as well as increase longevity via not only increasing telomerase activity, but also many other behaviors contained within the cell that are unlocked by exosomes. The third aspect of the Trimurti is Shiva, the destroyer. Just like we don't look at a tree in autumn and say, what a tragedy, some cells are destined to die, designed to die, have no telomerase activity, and that's fine. These cells include those that are killed during chemotherapy, such as skin, gut, nerves, and the blood-producing cells. So these cells do not have telomerase activity, and indeed they are meant to die like leaves on a tree. Now, when you keep a cell alive, it acquires incidental mutations, either from oxidation, from just erroneous copying, from electromagnetic rays, but most importantly, they have telomere shortening, and once the telomeres get too short, as I explained in my books, Telomere Time Bombs and the Telomere Miracle, then they become like chopped scallions and an infinite number of mutations occur. So when cells become old but not suicidal, they cause a bad ecology. They cause pro-inflammatory cytokines, maybe partially as an attempt to call for suicide or an airstrike, if you will. And this is known as the senescent-associated secretory phenotype. Now, one of the mitigating factors that came out in the 2017 paper was something called FOXO4-DRI. A very interesting study they did looking at mice, and they basically created a dummy key. The FOXO4 protein is something that puts the brakes on the master controller of cell suicide, known as P53. And instead of using naturally occurring levorotated or left-handed rotated amino acids, they used right-handed ones. The resulting experiments showed that the key fit the lock, but it dislodged the native FOXO4, therefore allowing the P53 to be unbound and execute the cell suicide program. This created a specific euthanizing, if you will, of the mice in many different phenotypes without any risk of other untoward symptoms. So it's a very exciting area of enhancing senolysis that we know as destruction of mutated but not suicidal cells. Now, exosomes might potentiate the destruction of senescent cells not only by increasing gene expression, you introduce the missing oncogenes that would allow for cell suicide. So for a transient moment, a cell that is stuck yet unable to kill itself because it lacks the protein might be given that protein by virtue of taking in an exosome, and it might be able to do that final step of suicide and hence clear out these damaged senescent cells. Also, if the immune system becomes more able to recognize senescent cells or cancer cells or better regulate autoimmunity, this might also help to clear out damage in our body that's accumulated. Of course, the fourth dimension of aging, time, we're all aware and we all thinking, well, how do I look? How do I act? How does that person, how do they act? We have to understand that perpetual motion machines don't exist. Anything that runs will accumulate damage through the fifth dimension, as we'll discuss. Now, what does time do to us? It doesn't do the same thing as it does to a bristlecone pine, which can live thousands of years, or an invertebrate jellyfish, which can grow to be massive. So we have to ask ourselves, why does time affect us so badly? Well, one of the answers lies in the hypothalamic pituitary axis, which is the control room for all our systems, including blood pressure, blood sugar, hormones, stress level, temperature, level of attention or arousal, the pigment of our skin, sex hormones and sexual function. The circadian clock in the hypothalamus, we assume, is influenced by both circadian rhythm, which has some component of a prion regulated mechanism. Prions are shape mimicry proteins, which are involved both in memory and plasticity of the neurons. But there's also a menstrual, meaning monthly, gravitometric sensor, which may exist. In other words, it literally counts how many moons you've been through and sort of marks, like a prisoner in a cell, how many moons we've gone through. And that hypothalamic clock may be keeping track, and it just may be able to be turned back like an odometer or reset like a clock. So the question is, if we can reset this, should we? And what will be the consequences? Well, exosomes may help rejuvenate or replace cells within the hypothalamic pituitary axis. And through cell signaling or reprogramming, they may even cause the timekeeper cells to express themselves differently. And I can definitely say that having taken exosomes for myself, it seemed to change some of the circadian aspects of my own timekeeping. The fifth dimension is entropy, which is a concept of general tendency towards disorder. So we see this throughout the matrix of our body. The extracellular scaffolding, the collagen, the bone, the cartilage, it all degrades, sort of like the vinyl dashboard on a car cracks over the years, or our sofa, you know, becomes worn. There are structures which are not meant to live forever. They need to be replenished. They acquire oxidation, cross-linking, basically degradation of their integrity. This applies both to the viscera and to the vessels, meaning the organs and the blood supply to all the organs throughout our body. When we talk about entropy or disorder, genetics is a very, very error-free process. Every time a cell divides into two daughters, the error correction is nearly perfect. And one estimate I saw was that there's only a one typographical error out of 3 billion possible letters in our genome every three divisions on average. So, you know, two times it's perfect, and the third time maybe there's one tiny little typographical error. But, of course, that can add up. It's my theory that epigenetics is a gainy process. This is a word I came up with in recording. Lossy means that you lose a little bit of integrity. It's generally a computer science term, but also an audio term. In other words, every copy is less than 100% perfect. But in contrast, epigenetics, because the stakes are high and we don't want old, primitive, dangerous genes to be expressed, perhaps, or perhaps just because of the nature of the machinery, I believe that the two daughters get a little over 100% of the gene silencing that the mother gives. So, in other words, this would account for the very, very high correlation between the epigenetic clock and the person's age. A 95% correlation is basically unheard of. But it doesn't mean necessarily what people think it means. It doesn't translate back into phenotypic age, but rather how long that cell line has been alive. And again, I refer you back to that Liu paper showing that telomerase active cells actually have a longer epigenetic clock life. They've been alive longer, and yet they may be acting very young. So exosomes may be both the cause and the result of aging. In other words, as the cells become mutated, Their protein signals, their mRNAs may become slightly off-tune, and this may be causing an unbalanced or older ecology, for example, cancer. In contrast, a younger individual might be producing exosomes that maintain a high degree of repair and regeneration. And we'll go into this more with the third lecture, parabiosis. So chimerism is an interesting topic. I bring this up because you talk about the Sphinx, which is part man and lion and eagle, or, you know, other sort of mixtures of animals and man, like the satyr, which is a goat and a man. What we're really becoming as we get older are chimeras unto ourselves. In other words, there's genetic divergence on a hardware level of the cells, as well as software divergence in the epigenetics. So our cells, far from speaking the same language, they start to diverge, they start to behave differently, and indeed part of aging is becoming a mosaic unto yourself. The immune system is a specific instance of this general trend towards chaos. Cells become chaotic and unable to talk to each other properly as they become divergent. So our belief is that exosomes from mesenchymal stem cells can direct clonal expansion of local stem cells, let's say in your cartilage or your heart. They can also, if need be, cause a de-differentiation, acting younger, if you will. And they can also recruit new stem cells to become locally available, engraft, and restore the matrix. The stem cell exosomes can also encourage a younger phenotype by changing the gene expression through upstream growth factors and mediators, and perhaps they can even provide genetic healing or repair through these mechanisms. In the end, the problem of aging is a problem of five dimensions, both stem cell creation, maintenance, destruction, as well as the voyage of these cells through time and through entropy. And it is our hope that the exosomes from mesenchymal stem cells can bring back a sort of younger expression. The younger music causes the older cells to dance a little livelier. So as we conclude, we have to ask the question again, what is aging? And I'm reminded of this this trend in art in the early 20th century known as cubism. And this was an attempt to look at a figure descending a staircase from multiple viewpoints at multiple times. And indeed, anybody that is wedded to one particular theory of aging is doomed to failure from the outset, because how can it be just one thing when there are many pathways to it? So we go back and we look from a distance and we say what things are generally true. And what things are generally true are the following. One, we have gene mutations, and that causes depletion of our cells and stem cells by what's known as replicative senescence. This process, or my stem cell telomere theory of aging, can be understood by reading either of my books, Telomere Time Bombs or The Telomere Miracle. Secondly, as we go through time, genes are being silenced by this greater than 100% efficiency of epigenetics. Which genes are turned on and off determine what kind of cell type it is and how it will behave. But it's my belief that this process is slightly over 100% efficient, leading to a very robust correlation with how old the cell lineage is and how methylated or silenced the genes are. Thirdly, we have a depletion of the immune system, its stemness, and those are the hematopoietic cells producing not only the white blood cells, the red blood cells, but also the all-important immune system, that is the police or military of our bodies. And there's also a depletion of the mesenchymal stem cells, which are the carpenters and the conductors and the musicians that go around and regulate repair and regeneration. Finally, there's a accumulation of damaged cells, the so-called senescence-associated secretory phenotype. These are just crotchety old cells that are pouring out a lot of signals to kill themselves, to just not behave, and they produce a bad ecological milieu. And senescence, in a nutshell, is just a damaged cell, damaged by virtue of replicative senescence, telomere shortening, and chromosome mutation, without the ability to kill themselves. Senescence is old, but not dead. We also have an accumulation of damaged extracellular matrix, or the connective tissues. They become like that dashboard in your sun-exposed car. We have an accumulation of intracellular junk and bad organelles, like mitochondria. But I think this is incidental. I think that these cells are largely disposable, and they're designed to be obsolete. In the grand scheme of things, we have large things that emerge, such as chimerism that I mentioned, autoimmunity, and its flip side of the coin, which may be the dysregulation of cancer, which we'll discuss more in a further lecture on cancer. What does young blood do? There's people who are in California, of course. Ambrosia stopped recently, but Alkahest and the Young Blood Institute are proposing to give young blood, which of course contains the exosomes, to older individuals to keep them young. The reason that we hope this would be helpful is both from mythology, like vampirism and such, but also there's solid science that implicates exosomes having a universal and potent paracrine effect, both in animals but also in humans, as far as some of the precursor preliminary studies in the clinic. The history of regenerative joint therapy is an interesting one, and it'll be covered in lecture 5 of this series. And in the next lecture, we'll cover parabiosis, or this mixing of young and old organisms, specifically plasma, and most specifically, the exosomes by implication. So in conclusion, when we look at the history of knowledge itself, we look at different models that are enhanced and somewhat augmented. In the old way of thinking, in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, we had these elements which were consisting of all these base elements that people knew of, such as gold, copper, lead, etc. Somewhere along the way, they invented the periodic table of elements, which was a very robust and excellent, elegant model of describing things. Of course, there are always different isotopes, different exceptions, different theoretical limits. And then we have this particle physics model coming out of the early 20th century in quantum mechanics. And we found out that indeed there are subatomic particles which make up these so-called elemental particles. So when we think about exosomes, we think about a very new area. Perhaps only around 2008 did research start picking up, and perhaps since 2014 did anyone really start to get interested in the meaning and the nomenclature. Before that, people were just throwing it out. And indeed, the use in humans is only about a year old, starting from 2018. So what are exosomes? Well, they're largely ignored because of their small size. Yet the theory is that, in fact, most of the action of cells, the communication, the reprogramming, perhaps was being mitigated by these very purposeful FedEx packages, and that this is where most of the action, where the music was being played. We don't know if the majority of cell-to-cell communication is mitigated by exosomes, but it seems likely that rather than just excreting them into the ocean, they package them into a bottle, if you will. And so the proteins, the mRNAs, and the interfering RNAs that are inside the exosomes are very purposeful, even if we don't understand the nature of the song. It follows that since cells are controlled by exosomes, that we can somehow mitigate aging and other diseases by learning to play back these songs, or at least recording them, and then reintroducing them to the desired dancers or cells. This concludes my lecture on aging, what it is, and how it might relate to exosomes. I encourage you to watch the next lecture entitled Parabiosis, because this will get into the very interesting topic of how cells from young people produce exosomes that can rejuvenate we the older. Thank you so much.